Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Nietzsche, A Very Short Introduction, by Michael Tanner, narrated by Christine Williams.
Chapter 1. The Image of Nietzsche. Friedrich Nietzsche was a German philosopher, almost wholly neglected during his sane life, which came to an abrupt end early in 1889. Nietzsche is the figure in whose name people of the most astonishingly discrepant and various views have sought to find justification for them. An excellent study devoted to his impact within Germany between 1890 and 1990 lists, among those who have found inspiration in his work, anarchists, feminists, Nazis, religious cultists, socialists, Marxists, vegetarians, avant-garde artists, devotees of physical culture, and arch-conservatives. And it certainly does not need to stop there. The front cover sports a bookplate from 1900 of Nietzsche wearing a crown of thorns, the back cover one of him naked with remarkable musculature posing on an Alp. Almost no German cultural or artistic figure of the last 90 years has not acknowledged his influence, from Thomas Mann to Jung to Heidegger. The story in Anglo-Saxony, to use the term in the title of one book about him, which traces his influence in the Western English-speaking world, is similar. Wave after wave of Nietzscheanism has broken over it, though there have been periods when he was in abeyance, being seen as the inspirer of German militarism, and so to be vilified by the Allies. He was extensively and most inaccurately translated into English, or a language strangely connected with it, in the early years of the century. For all its archaizing grotesqueness, or partly because of that, it was the only translation of many of Nietzsche's works for almost 50 years. Then, when his reputation was at its lowest in England and the United States, Walter Kaufmann, an emigre professor of philosophy at Princeton, began retranslating many of the key works, and launched the enterprise with a book that had, for many years after its first appearance in 1950, a determining influence on the way Nietzsche was viewed. Kaufmann presented a philosopher who was a much more traditional thinker than the one who had inspired anarchists, vegetarians, etc. To widespread surprise, and only slightly less widespread agreement, Nietzsche turned out to be a reasonable man, even a rationalist. Kaufmann sought to establish comprehensively his remoteness from the Nazis, from all irrationalist movements that had claimed him as their forebear, and from Romanticism in the arts. It became difficult on this version to see what all the fuss had been about. Thus began the academicization of Nietzsche, one philosopher among others, to be compared and contrasted with Spinoza, Kant, Hegel, and other leading names in the Western philosophical tradition. Reassured by the breadth of Kaufmann's learning, American philosophers, and then increasingly English ones, took him as a starting point for their studies of Nietzsche on objectivity, the nature of truth, his relationship to Greek thought, the nature of the self, and other harmless topics, at any rate as treated in their books and articles. Meanwhile in Europe, Nietzsche, who had never been in disgrace there, became after World War II a continued object of study and appropriation for existentialists, phenomenologists, and then increasingly, during the 1960s and 1970s, a cynosure for critical theorists, post-structuralists, and deconstructionists. When the latter two movements first gained a foothold in the United States, then took the country over, it was Nietzsche who once more was acknowledged as the major source of their inspiration. Some analytical philosophers, too, found that he was not so remote from their interests as they had assumed, and in that reciprocal motion that is so characteristic of academic life, congratulated him on having had, in embryonic fashion, some of their insights, while at the same time reassuring themselves about those insights by invoking his authority. There is now a flourishing Nietzsche industry, and almost certainly more books appear on him each year than on any other thinker, thanks to the appeal he has for so many disparate schools of thought and anti-thought. It is idle to pretend that he would have been entirely displeased by this phenomenon. During his lifetime, and unless I specify otherwise, I shall always mean by that the one that finished when he went mad in 1889, 11 years before his death, he was almost completely neglected, and though that did not make him bitter, as hardly anything did, it caused him distress, because he believed that he had vital truths to impart to his contemporaries which they were ignoring at a terrible cost, one of his most accurate prophecies. But he would have looked with scorn on almost everything that has been written or done under his aegis, and the successful takeover by the academic world, though it cannot compare in horror with some of the other appropriations he has suffered, would have seemed to him most like a final defeat, because he wanted at all costs not to be assimilated to the world of learning, where everything becomes a matter for discussion and nothing for action. Before we move into an account of his views, it is worth stopping briefly and pondering what it might be about his work that has proved so attractive to such diverse movements and schools of thought. Only later will a clearer answer emerge, but it seems, as a preliminary explanation, that it is precisely the idiosyncrasies of his manner that are first found refreshing. His books, after the early The Birth of Tragedy and the Untimely Meditations, are usually composed of short essays, often less than a page long and verging on the aphoristic, though, as we shall see, crucially different from aphorisms as normally composed and appreciated. That is, one or two line encapsulations of the nature of human experience demanding acceptance through their lapidary certainty. The number of subjects discussed is vast, including many that it is surprising to find mentioned by a philosopher, such matters as climate, diet, exercise, and Venice. And often his reflections are in no particular order. That means that he is much easier than most philosophers to dip into, and his frequently expressed loathing of systems means that one can do that with a good conscience. Many of his quasi-aphorisms are radical in content, and though one may gain only a vague impression of what he favors, one will certainly find out a great deal about his dislikes, most often expressed in terms that are both witty and extreme. What he seems to dislike is every aspect of contemporary civilization, most particularly that of the Germans, and for the reader, that is bracing. His underlying view is that if we don't make a drastically new start, we are doomed, since we are living in the wreckage of 2,000 and more years of fundamentally mistaken ideas about almost everything that matters, in, as it were, the decadence of what was anyway deadly, offers carte blanche to people who fancy the idea of a clean break with their whole cultural inheritance. Nietzsche was under no illusions about the impossibility of such a schism. Even so, the variety of interpretations of his work, which far from diminishing as the decades pass, seem to be multiplying, though in less apocalyptic forms than previously, needs more explanation. It suggests to the outsider that he must have been exceptionally vague and probably contradictory. There is something in both those charges, but they seem more impressive and damning than they are if one does not realize and continually keep in mind that in the 16 years during which he wrote his mature works, from B.T. onwards, he was developing his views at a rate that has no parallel, and that he rarely went to the bother of signposting his changes of mind. What he more often did was to try to see his earlier works in a new light, surveying his career in a way that suggests he thought one could not understand his later writings without a knowledge of his previous ones, to see how he had advanced, and thus taking himself to be exemplary of how modern man, immured in the decaying culture of the 19th century, might move from acquiescence in it to rebellion and suggestions for radical transformation. In 1886 in particular, when he was on the verge, though he could not have known it, of his last creative phase, he spent a great deal of energy on his previous books, providing new, sometimes harshly critical, introductions to them, and in the case of The Gay Science, writing a long, new, final book. No doubt this was part of his program for showing that nothing in one's past should be regretted, that there need be no waste. But many commentators have been led astray by assuming that it gave them license to treat all his writings as though they had been produced simultaneously. Another factor that is made for misreadings and shocking distortions is a consequence of the fact that from 1872 at least, but probably before that, Nietzsche must have spent most of his time writing. The tally of published books is impressive enough, but he noted down at least as much as he organized into books, and unfortunately much of this unpublished writing, the Nachlass, has survived. It would not be unfortunate if there were a universally accepted methodological principle that what he did not publish should under all circumstances be clearly demarcated from what he did. But almost no one observes that elementary rule. Even those who claim that they will do this usually slip into unattributed quoting from the immense Nachlass when it confirms the line that they are taking on him. What makes this a particularly dangerous way of proceeding is that on some central concepts, among which the will to power and the eternal recurrence are perhaps the most important, his thought remained so undeveloped. Nietzsche was often so sure he had struck philosophical gold that he jotted down very many thoughts, but left them unworked out. This provides a commentator with the possibility of pursuing trains of thought that he is attributing to Nietzsche, unimpeded by definite statements. Some have even taken the view that the real Nietzsche is to be found in the notebooks, the published work being a kind of elaborate, very elaborate, set of concealments. That absurd attitude is taken by Heidegger, who is thus enabled to peddle his own philosophy as deriving from and also critical of Nietzsche. Like all his other commentators, I shall occasionally quote from the Nachlass, but I shall indicate when I am doing that. Nietzsche took great pains over the finished form of what he published, and he was the last person to think that style was an optional extra. Since he was a natural stylist, his jottings make more elegant reading than most philosophers' finished products. But when one compares his published thoughts with his draft versions of them, the difference is striking enough to make anyone cautious of taking them as being on a par, one would have thought. I emphasize this point because, as we shall see, the manipulation of what Nietzsche wrote has been a major factor in myth-making about him. None of this explains adequately how Nietzsche could come to be portrayed as the man of sorrows, or indeed in many other guises. For all his ambiguities and his careful lack of definition of an ideal, one would have thought there were limits to the extent of possible misrepresentations. All I can lamely say here is that evidently there appear to be no limits. If someone develops a reputation as vast as his rapidly became once he was no longer in a position to do anything about it, it seems that he will be unscrupulously used to give credentials to any movement that needs an icon. Here, as in some other respects, he does with awful irony come to resemble his antipode, the Crucified One. Almost the last words he wrote were, "I have a duty against which my habits, even more the pride of my instincts, revolt at bottom. Listen to me, for I am thus and thus. Do not, above all, confound me with what I am not." In the century since he wrote that, few of his readers, fewer still who have heard about him, have done anything else. Chapter 2. Tragedy, Birth, Death, Rebirth. Nietzsche was a precocious student, but though he wrote copiously from an early age, his first book, The Birth of Tragedy, or to give the first edition its full title, The Birth of Tragedy from the Spirit of Music, only appeared when he was 27. Its hostile reception in the academic world, where he had received such early advancement as to be appointed professor of classical philology at Basel at the age of 24, should not have surprised him, but apparently it did. It meets no conceivable standards of rigor, let alone those that obtained in the study of the ancient Greeks. A broadside soon appeared over the name of an old enemy from his school days, Ulrich von Wilamowitz Möhlendorf, who charged him with ignorance, distortion of the facts, and grotesque parallels between Greek culture and the modern world. Erwin Rode, a staunch friend, replied in terms at least as pugnacious, and the kind of battle familiar in academic circles directed to those who offend against their canons ensued. Nietzsche had gained notoriety, but it was brief, and was the only kind of fame with which he was ever to be acquainted. Readers ever since have been divided into those who find its rhapsodic style and the content which necessitates it intoxicating, and those who respond with bored contempt. Both are readily understandable. It is a whirlwind of a book, swept along by the intensity of its strange set of enthusiasms and its desire to cope with as many topics as possible in a short space, but masquerading as a historical account of why Greek tragedy lasted for so short a time, and arguing that it had recently been reborn in the mature works of Richard Wagner. Nietzsche had been a fanatical admirer of some of Wagner's dramas since he encountered the score of Tristan und Isolde, which he and some friends had played on the piano and quasi-sung when he was 16. And he had met the composer and his then-mistress Cosima, daughter of Liszt, in 1868, becoming their close friend in 1869, and visiting them often during the years that they lived in Triebschen on Lake Lucerne. There is no doubt that the whole subject matter of BT had been discussed frequently during those visits, and that Wagner contributed substantially to the development of some of its central theses. But when he and Cosima received their copy of the book, they were nevertheless bowled over by it. However much influence Wagner, who adored pseudo-historical speculation, may have had, there was enough that was new to him in the book for him to find it a revelation. Generally sympathetic readers of the book have often regretted that its last 10 sections are largely devoted to a consideration of Wagner's art as the rebirth of Greek tragedy. Not only does the claim seem to them in itself absurd, but also they feel it detracts and distracts from the unity, such as it is, of the first two-thirds of BT. That is almost wholly to miss the point of the book's endeavor, and of what Nietzsche spent his life trying to do. For what makes BT the indispensable start to Nietzsche's writing career, for those who want to understand the underlying unity of his concerns, is the manner in which he begins with a set of issues which seem to be remote from the present time, but gradually reveals that his underlying concern is with culture, its perennial conditions, and the enemies of their fulfillment. BT begins at a spanking pace, and the momentum never lets up. It is a good idea to read it for the first time as fast as one can, ignoring obscurities and apparent diversions from the central argument, that term being used in a generously broad sense. Such an initial reading certainly involves taking a lot on trust, but to subject it to critical scrutiny for the first time through is a recipe for irritation and ennui. It is important to get the sense of flux which the book possesses, and which is to some extent also its subject matter. After the preface to Richard Wagner, which mentions both the serious German problem we are dealing with, and the conviction that art is the supreme task and the truly metaphysical activity of this life, Nietzsche begins the book proper with the claim, "We shall have gained much for the science of aesthetics when we have succeeded in perceiving directly, and not only through logical reasoning, that art derives its continuous development from the duality of the Apolline and Dionysiac." So within the space of a very few lines, Nietzsche has shown that he is going to be advancing on three fronts. The first mentioned is that of the contemporary crisis in German culture, the second an audacious claim about the nature of metaphysics, and the third a concern with the science of aesthetics. For science, Nietzsche uses the word Wissenschaft, which covers any systematic investigation, and not what is meant by science in English. This should be remembered throughout his work, or indeed any discussion in German. He rapidly moves on to dealing with the opposition between the Apolline and the Dionysiac, but that should not be taken to mean that they are enemies. As his exposition unfolds, it immediately becomes clear that these two very different tendencies walk side by side, usually in violent opposition to one another, inciting one another to ever more powerful births, until they seem at last to beget the work of art that is as Dionysiac as it is Apolline, Attic tragedy. This kind of opposition, which yet contrives to be immensely more fruitful than anything that could be produced by either of the opponents going it alone, is characteristic of 19th-century German philosophy, its leading exponent being Hegel, a philosopher to whom Nietzsche was in general strongly antagonistic throughout his life, no doubt in part because of his attachment to Schopenhauer, whose loathing of Hegel was notorious. But in the elaboration of the opposition and its overcoming, Nietzsche does not need any of the dialectical apparatus that Hegel encumbers himself with. For he can work out his scheme by means of images and examples, and that is what he does, though the examples are often used tendentiously. The idea is that the Apolline is the art of appearance, indeed is appearance. Nietzsche invokes dreams to make his point, that at its most representative, Apolline art has extraordinary clarity, giving hard edges to what it depicts, exemplifying the principium individuationis, the principle of individuation, which Schopenhauer had located as the major error that we suffer from epistemologically. We perceive and conceive of the world in terms of separate objects, including separate persons. As beings with sense organs and conceptual apparatus, we cannot avoid this fundamentally erroneous way of viewing the world, and for Schopenhauer, it is responsible for many of our most painful illusions and experiences. though it is unclear that overcoming it should lead to our lives being any less frightful. Nietzsche traded in BT on the confusions in Schopenhauer's thought. It is nowhere evident that he was any more aware of them than Schopenhauer himself, to produce his own, somewhat independent, artist's metaphysics, as he contemptuously refers to his procedure in The Attempt at a Self-Criticism, the magnificent introduction that he wrote to the third edition of the book in 1886, The Year of Self-Reckoning. By that phrase, artist's metaphysics, he meant partly a metaphysics tailor-made to give art an importance that he later came to regard as preposterous, and partly the use of artistic or pseudo-artistic methods to produce metaphysical views, testing them by their beauty rather than for their truth. One way of looking at BT is as a transcendental argument in Kant's sense. What that comes to in general is the following pattern. X is the case, the datum. What else may be the case in order for that X to be possible? Nietzsche's datum is very unlike that found in any other philosopher, since it gives primacy to our aesthetic experience, normally low on the list of philosophical priorities when it figures at all. He takes the experiences we have of Apolline art, sculpture, painting, above all the epic, and Dionysiac art, music, tragedy, as his data, and asks how the world must be in order for these experiences to be vouchsafed us. We have seen that he compares Apolline art to dreams. Dionysiac art is aligned rather, as a first indication of its nature, with intoxication, the low way in which the principle of individuation is felt to be overcome, the loss of clarity and the merging of individualities. Why do we need them both, once we have grasped that one is the representation of beautiful appearance, while the other enables us to experience reality so far as we can without being destroyed by it? Because we are so constructed that doses of reality must be reserved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.